In this episode of the On.NET Show, I have my good friend Jeff Hollan coming on to talk to us about how we could build serverless applications with both Blazor and Azure Functions. Check it out. Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the On.NET Show. My name is Cecil Phillip, and I'm actually super excited because I have one of the people that I have a lot of respect for, hope you have a lot of respect for. I have with me today, Mr. Serverless, Mr. Jeff Hollan. How are you doing, sir?
Fantastic to be back. I'm doing great.
I'm really happy that you're able to join us today. Now, everybody knows you for obviously talking about Azure Functions and serverless and Microsoft in general, but I kind of feel like you have some new stuff that you want to show us today. A little bit less about like the product and more so about how we could use things together in the Microsoft ecosystem to create some interesting applications.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm nothing if not a fan of buzzwords. So if it's not serverless, it's got to be some other stuff.
Sure.
So today I want to talk some about things like WebAssembly and specifically Blazor and how .NET developers have this kind of brand new world of development patterns open to them with some of this new tech like Blazor that .NET Core 3 started to light up.
Sure. So I feel like in the .NET ecosystem in general, like Blazor's like the new hotness, right? Everybody's talking about Blazor and writing like these client-rendered applications. So we haven't had a tremendous amount of conversation on the show about it. So why don't we get like your view of what is Blazor and what are some of the benefits of using something like that, particularly too in a serverless context?
Absolutely. So Blazor's kind of made up of two pieces, or I guess there's two flavors of it, and we'll show one of them more strongly than the other. But really, it's about this nice .NET framework for writing web applications, specifically like single-paged application-styled apps.
Yeah.
Now, the traditional Blazor, or I guess the one that more people may be familiar with, I know I was when I used like Razor Pages, is server-side rendered Blazor.
Yeah.
So you can write a Blazor app, you deploy it, just like you might any .NET web application. Mm-hmm. You've got this nice reactive style pattern to use. But this new emerging one that actually pairs very closely with serverless are these client-side rendered Blazor apps. Mm-hmm. And in that case, what makes this unique is that you still write a .NET application. Like you're writing a .NET application, you have, you know, hey, here's my element of HTML that I need to be rendered. Here's the .NET code that I need to be evaluated. It's going to be compiled into DLLs and binaries. But what's crazy here is that this Blazor, this .NET code, will actually execute inside of a web browser. So there's new technology called WebAssembly, which pretty much let any web browser, whether it's Safari, Chrome, Edge, they can actually execute binaries. So traditionally, if you wanted to have code run in the browser, your only option was really JavaScript, because JavaScript was the only language that a web browser could interpret.
Yeah.
But now with Blazor and this client-side WebAssembly-powered .NET, you can now write a .NET app that can get compiled and actually run directly on like Internet Explorer or Edge, but still run all your .NET code to do all the logic.
And that's a pretty interesting scenario for a lot of our developers because, you know, JavaScript is great, great community over there, and tons of great packages and resources. But for me, like, if I could reuse my knowledge of C# and .NET and, you know, write something that runs on the server and on the client and be able to, like, have them talk to each other, like, that's a huge benefit for me and a lot less stuff for me to have to worry about in terms of, like, oh, man, how do I set up this thing or how do I build it and how do I get it ready for deployment, right?
Yeah, and I not only do I like that I can reuse the languages that I know and I'm familiar with, but even the ability to like share things like classes where I have a class that needs to be filled out here and it's going to be submitted to the server and I can actually just share the same class in both spots without having to be like, okay, I need to switch this to JSON and JavaScript's going to do it that way. It just kind of clicks together really nice.
Yeah, that's great. And so now, why is there such an interest now, I find with folks, with having these client-side rendered apps with serverless, right? Like, there must be, like, an interesting benefit there, because people, everybody's talking about it, right? Like, all across the ecosystem.
You ready to go on a ride? I've got some visuals
here.
Visual aids!
Let me see what you got.
Let's do it. So if we think about a standard web application, it looks a little bit like this, where you've got the browser, it's making a request to a website, and you can imagine that this is an ASP.NET site.
Yep.
It's going to hit the server. The server's going to render the code like we talked about and then return back an index.html, which the browser renders. This is sometimes called like the three-tiered architecture.
Sure.
Now, the downside of this pattern is that if I have immense scale, like I have a bunch of requests that happens, maybe a huge burst promotion, I now need to scale up a bunch of instances of my server, and I need a bunch of instances of the server all rendering their little copies of an index.html page.
Right.
So it's kind of cumbersome to scale. But even then, maybe it's the inverse problem. Maybe I don't actually have a site that's super popular. Mm-hmm. Maybe I actually also have a site that's not popular at all.
Right.
The problem with kind of this approach is that I need a server running 24/7 in order to be able to serve those web requests, even if only one or two people are going to their website a day or a week. So what's interesting about these new Blazor type apps and where it fits with serverless is that now I can take that same application. So let's say I want to go to jeffhollan.com. But now instead of having to hit an ASP.NET site that's going to render the HTML, it's actually just going to hit a storage account. And that storage account's just going to return back an index.html page that's going to reference things like Blazor files. It's going to reference things like CSS. But here, rather than the server doing all of the rendering, it's actually just pulling back a static page. And then that page, the browser itself, I mentioned the .NET can run in the browser. Now it's up to the browser to actually render that code. So this is nice because now I'm not paying for a web server. I'm just paying for a few files in a storage account. And whenever those files need to be, you know, rendered, then it just pulls in those files and renders them all on the machine. So you pay like maybe nothing, like pennies a month to do this. And at the same time, if it needs to scale, I'm just scaling that storage account. I'm scaling that file in storage. But all the hard work's actually happening on the customer's web browser.
Right, and that makes a lot of sense. Because I can imagine like storage is probably a little bit cheaper than compute.
Yeah, for sure.
Right, and so now we're not worried about like, you know, crunching strings and rendering HTML and processing CSS and like all these other things to send to the browser. We can do a lot more of that interaction upfront on the user's machine using their own, you know, whether they're using Edge or Chrome or whatever the case is, and that could just kind of happen in their own space. But I think another thing that's interesting there too now is that .NET developers now have the ability to interact with the web platform. Mm-hmm. So whether we're talking about like local storage or we're talking about like, you know, the fetch clients or any of those other interesting things that are very native to the browser, we have a way to interact with those features as well.
Yeah, it's super powerful. And the other reason that serverless comes in handy is because maybe somewhere in this website, I do need to call some actual data.
Sure.
Like I've got a SQL database or a Cosmos DB database, and I need to pull that data in to render my page. Mm. Now, while I could run .NET in the browser and I could have my browser connect directly to Cosmos, it gives me a little bit of heebie-jeebies to think that I have all these browsers connecting directly to my database.
Right, right.
So the other pattern we see very common with this is, hey, I actually might need some code that runs in the cloud. And that's where our good friend Azure Functions comes in.
Right.
So also serverless, same benefits in that it's a lot less expensive than traditional compute. But here, my browser can make a call to say like, hey, go get me some data, calls a function written in .NET as well, goes and fetches that data securely in the server and returns it back. So I still can have some server-side logic, but using this new framework, I don't have a traditional web server. I've got these serverless functions and this Blazor client-side code. They're kind of playing hand in glove with each other.
And that's amazing because if you think about the scale across not only your front end, but your back end as well, but you have a tremendous amount of flexibility, right? And again, the whole thing about serverless is that I don't have to think about these machines that are in the back that are doing the work, right? So if I had tons of these front end clients running Blazor and you know the load increases exponentially, like my function code, my serverless code is just going to increase exponentially as well. And then up front, like we have blob storage, we can put something in front of it like Azure CDN. Mm-hmm. That'll help with like the caching and the geolocation of that. So clients all over the world could be able to hit these static assets and not really have to worry about like provisioning these things like all over the place.
Yeah, and in like the scenario you mentioned, we've actually had customers do exactly that.
Really?
So one of the cool stuff we've seen a customer do is they had a retail site that mm-hmm. was built on WordPress. It was kind of like the traditional servers architecture that I talked about, server full.
Yeah.
But they wanted to run a massive promotion, and they were like, we're going to get thousands of hits every second. We can't scale our back-end database enough. So what they actually did is for the pages that were going to be impacted by the promotion, mm-hmm. they turned that into this new serverless web architecture. So the bulk of the site was still kind of this WordPress site. But then when that incredible amount of traffic happened, to your point, they're just scaling all these client-side browsers. They have these functions in the storage account with CDN. So the site was able to handle this incredible amount of load by taking advantage of this architecture as an extension to their existing app even. So people find a lot of use in saying, not only is this less expensive, it's super elastic.
Right. And with Azure Functions, not only do we write Blazor in .NET, but we can write Azure Functions in .NET. Mm-hmm. So again, like .NET in the backend, .NET in the front end, and everybody's happy.
It's the best way to write any code, honestly. JavaScript's great and all. Blazor's way better.
Sure. So why don't we talk a little bit about how we can actually do this? Like, what does it look like from a developer perspective to create a Blazor app, create a function app, and kind of like have them work together?
Yep. So Blazor right now is in preview as part of .NET Core 3.
Yep.
So the first thing you need to do is just make sure you install the right templates. So if you head to the .NET Core Blazor site, it'll make sure you install the right templates for your .NET CLI. Mm-hmm. And then you get a bunch of new templates. The one we've been talking about today is this Blazor WASM, which is WebAssembly. So that's Blazor that runs on the client. Mm-hmm. So once you get the templates installed, it's really about just as easy as just spinning up a project.
Okay.
So I'm here in an empty directory. Mm-hmm. I can say .NET new and Blazor WASM, as I mentioned, the Blazor that runs in WebAssembly.
Okay.
It's going to scaffold out for me a Blazor site that I can get started with. I could customize it. I could add even interact with JavaScript in the site if I wanted to.
Sure.
But this looks super traditional, right? I've got an index page, which has just some simple HTML. I see a little annotation here. If I come here to my counter, you'll see there's a little bit more C# code. And then finally, there's an example of something that's actually going to fetch data from a database. I don't know why this gets me so excited, but seeing HTTP client and knowing that my old friend HTTP client is actually going to be running in the browser
right.
just makes me so excited. So this is a simple template here that if I wanted to, I could then customize. I could have it call functions as needed. But when I say .NET run, it's going to compile it, generate all the WebAssembly artifacts that it needs. And when I run this locally on my box, it's actually going to be running all that .NET code directly in my browser, doing this code that I set up.
Right. So essentially, like, so we're using the .NET CLI. It's going to package up all that code together, convert it into WASM, right? Mm-hmm. Or it's going to write DLLs and have a WASM connectivity layer.
Yep.
Right. And then that's going to load up the runtime and like pull in our DLLs, and we can run it in the browser.
It's really cool. Like, I know it looks the same as every other demo. Like, you're looking at this and you don't know, but just know that all the logic here, like incrementing this counter, is counter plus plus in .NET. And this fetch data is fetching this weather using HTTP client, now just running through the .NET CLI, as you mentioned, kind of setting up the bridge between my .NET code and WebAssembly, in this case, in my Edge browser.
Right. Awesome. So how do we add some Azure Functions to this? Like, I love Azure Functions. I know you love Azure Functions.
I love them.
Right. How can we mix a little bit of Blazor and Azure Functions together?
Yeah. So in the same way, kind of following that fetch data pattern, which is a great one, if I wanted to maybe modify this and instead of calling, in this case, it's calling actually just a static JSON file.
Mm-hmm.
So an example of one, let's say I added in a new page here, which is going to pull in some function data.
Okay.
Let me just populate this really quickly with some code.
Sure.
So here, I'm just going to use my old friend HTTP client, and I could call an Azure function. So using the Azure Functions extension, I already have a function that I spun up. I won't go through creating that in Visual Studio Code. This would be an example of a function that I could deploy and run in the cloud. This one's really simple. It just returns back hello.
Yeah.
But by deploying that function, even in the same workspace as the Blazor app, I can now have this code running in the server in .NET. And then using my Blazor file here, I'm using just the HTTP client to call that API.
Right.
And so now I've been able to pair those two together nicely. And if I wanted to, like, let's just kind of finish this out since we've gotten this far. Let's add a navigation item so we can actually navigate to this new page that I just created. And now, I think that's everything I need. If I come back in here and say .NET run, it's going to go ahead now and spin up a Blazor app. But in this case, it's going to call that function running in the cloud, use that function to return data back to us here on the client.
Right, because before, like you said, we were using that static JSON document that was just available.
Should we test it out?
Yeah, let's try it.
Let's see what happens. I'm a little, so if I refresh this, I should see a new page, which is functions.
Okay.
It's calling out to that function. Right now it's loading, and it says the message is hello. So it called the function. There a function returned back my data, and I used that data to dynamically render this Blazor page.
This looks pretty awesome. You know what? Like, it would be great if there was like some type of community project that would create like a Blazor functions template.
Yeah, like together. Like I say .NET new, Blazor serverless, and it gives me like my function, my Blazor app, and whatever else I might need to get that all wired up.
That'd be pretty cool. So if you're watching, a little bit of homework for you.
I agree.
That'd be a great thing to see. Because I really love the pairing of these two technologies together. again, like we said before, like being able to use the same language across both the front end and the back end, but also to having the power of the cloud, the power of Azure behind to manage the scaling for us, be able to manage like the distribution for us. I don't have to worry about like updating machines and doing networking or doing any of that type of stuff. Like it could all just happen as a part of like the infrastructure that we're already paying for. And again, like because it's serverless, it's like a pay-per-use model, right? So the same thing with blob storage, like we pay for the storage that we use. And just like with Azure Functions, we're going to pay for the amount of compute that we use.
Yep, it's awesome. It's a perfect way. Like this is how I'm running my personal blog right now.
Oh, is it?
If any, speaking of homework, like that's such a nice project to do this on. It's like, hey, right. I've got a really simple site. Let me try to spin this up, pair these two together. And I pay maybe like a penny a month on this thing because I'm not super popular as much as you flatter me.
I don't believe you.
Not a lot of people go to jeffhollan.com, but it's fun.
Homework number two, go to jeffhollan.com after you see this.
How much homework do you give these people?
I mean, that's how the product gets better, right? We got to get feedback.
That's awesome.
But this is great, man. So thank you so much for coming on and showing us this. If everybody that's watching, they want to get in contact with you or the team or anything like that, where are some places that they could reach out and share their feedback or just learn about like functions and using functions with Blazor?
Yeah, so good places to keep in mind. We have a monthly live webcast where usually myself and a few members from the functions team will give updates. It's kind of like the .NET community stand-ups, but a little, you know, we have less frequent updates than them. So worth following that once a month on YouTube.
Okay.
Reaching out to us directly on like social media like Twitter, at Azure Functions, you can reach out to me directly as well.
Mm-hmm.
Or our team's actively monitoring forms like Stack Overflow.
Sure.
So even if you post a question which is like, hey, I'm trying to do this thing Jeff showed of functions in Blazor, I'm running into issues, we'll find it on Stack Overflow too.
Sure. Awesome, man. Well, thank you so much, man. I really love when you come on here because I feel like the excitement level just like explodes out of the room.
Ditto that.
Awesome, man. Well, thank you again. And so if you like this video, please like, you know, send us some feedback if you'd like to see more things like this. You know, leave some comments down in the boxes below. And thank you so much for spending your time watching this episode of the On.NET Show.